Good afternoon, one and all present here on this auspicious day. I, Saurav Das, on behalf of Sri Balaji Society, is profoundly privileged and enchanted to introduce you to our next speaker of the day, Mr. Vikram Berry, sir, Director of Marketing and Sales at Vivanta by Taz. Now, I would like to urge Vikram, sir, to come to the dice and share his experience and elevate our knowledge as well as our lives. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. I think you've all got my name very loud and clear, and I don't want to keep repeating it. It's also somewhere on the screen which I kept looking at so that you don't forget who I am. And I've been given the most difficult slot to talk. I call it the sleeping slot. You know, you had a tummy full of lunch, and you've all had quite a few speakers before me. So let me give you an insight about who I am, what I do. And I'm not a big speaker in terms of standing behind the counter and addressing everybody. I like to have a more interactive session. I do believe firmly that you all are much smarter than I am. You are the Gen X, and you are going to be able to take this country and this entire institute to places where you want it to go. So like they introduced me in the onset, my name is Vikram Berry. I am the Director of Sales and Marketing at Vivanta by Taj Dwarka in New Delhi. Yes, I have had the opportunity and the privilege from God to be able to work through various industries and segments. And I have been in a position where I've had taken some right decisions as well as some wrong decisions. But I like to look at it as a learning, I like to look at it as a growth, and I most importantly like to look at it as an opportunity that I've been given in my life. So on that note, a very good afternoon, and thank you so much, sir, for having me here today to be able to address this group of young boys and girls and be of relevance at this time of your life when you're going to make a decision of where you want to be, who you want to be, and where you want to go. When this opportunity was given to me, I was told to do a talk on the futuristic trends and challenges to business school. I thought I'll put a nice presentation, I'll write a lot, but I'm glad I didn't do that. I'm very happy. I must say you are all a very privileged lot, and please excuse me if I don't keep looking up. You're all a very privileged lot to be studying in a campus and in an environment as beautiful as this. I am pleasantly pleased, and I must say you all should absolutely put a pat on your own back to be able to be selected for being able to study in an institute. One of you worked with me in your summer intern and did turn around and tell me that, sir, it's a beautiful campus today. I agree with you, yes, it is a beautiful campus. So a big round of applause to yourself, everybody. I think you all deserve every bit of it. What am I really going to talk about? What am I really going to share with you? What is it that you don't know and you're waiting for me to teach you? I really don't know. But what I am going to share with you is something that I very strongly believe in, and that is experiential training. That is training while you're learning. The power of business education in the very recent past has come to a level of intense amount of desire. Everybody wants to do business education. The truth is actually that the demand for education broadly has never been higher, and business education continues to dominate the student choice. Each one of you wants to do a master's or a postgraduate in business administration. On that note, there are different verticals, there are different sections, and there are different parts of each and every business school that you all want to excel in. As I mentioned to you, I do strongly believe that business is the most powerful force for economic and social impact. And a good institute not only creates the next generation of business leaders, but also prepares them on ways and means to deal with the ever-changing social and the economic environment. You all know what I mean when I say social and economic environment. What I'm basically trying to tell you is the environment that we all live in. And that environment is predominantly governed by the businesses that are running in that area where we are staying. And that is what controls the economy. That's what controls us, and that's what controls our future. We all know that business is the most powerful force for change in the world. It is this constant change that also works as a major threat to the education system. Do you think it is possible for the education system to keep up with the regular change that you're all going through. No. What you study today may be very different from where you're going tomorrow. But that really isn't how we want to look at it and say that, okay, now that means I don't need to study. Well, I wish life was so simple. And I could go back and say, no, I don't want to. But that's not the case. What we really have to understand is that the keynote with which the institution needs to work today is to align more closely with various corporate houses in the business environment. And that is where experiential learning or education comes forward. Having worked closely with a lot of business school students, both in the intern role, as well as students who have been recently, or I call them as the new hire in my area, have been constantly, and I say this once every now and then, they always want to learn, and they want to learn while they're creating, constructing, and collaborating. This also comes by the virtue of instant recognition and gratification that today's society is built around. Today, I urge all of you to go back and look at what and how important are the aspects that you are learning right now. Because in all these years, the norm of yesterday is being questioned as the relevance for today. Do you understand that line? So this is something that my mentor taught me. Something that was a norm yesterday or something that was a mandate yesterday, in today's time and age, and constant change is being questioned even if it is relevant. Do we really even need to do that? Questioning is a mandate, is a right, and is something that each one of you as students are capable of doing. But not following the norm is not something that is really relevant at this stage. So you need to understand the difference of relevance and mandate. Management education adds value to your existing qualification. It helps all of you, irrespective of your domains of graduation, as it widens your knowledge base and encourages you to think differently. So somebody asked me the other day that how come now suddenly management has become so relevant as compared to the yesteryears? And my answer lies here. It allows you to widen your knowledge base and encourages you to think differently. Thinking differently is the key. It of course helps you to enhance your managerial and leadership skills. It allows you to share ideas. I have been made to understand by sir that you are all from various parts of the world. You all have different backgrounds. You all have different education, upbringing. And you are all such a lucky lot to be able to interact with each other today, to see what really works and what is your USP or your strength versus someone else. That's what management school is all about. It allows you to enhance your capabilities and competencies to take on to the corporate challenge with full confidence. With this attitude, I ask you to look at three very, very basic skills. The first skill that you must always, always, always go back and look at. I've been made to understand that all of you have already finished your intern. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
All right, so you're all still awake. Good to know. The first skill that I really want all of you to go back and look at is fast beats big. Would anybody like to tell me what I mean when I say fast beats big? Do we have mics around for the... Or are you all loud enough? Okay, so we'll get into that later. In time of unprecedented change, those who are prepared to think fast are those who are moving forward. Those who move fast and get things done and keep getting things done are the ones moving forward. Others dwell in a state of aggressive indecision, and inaction breeds decay. So now, is it a little more clear to you what I mean when I say fast beats big? What helps you? You got a problem today. What are you going to do? Are you going to sit down and you're going to think about the problem and you're going to think about how and what and where you want to take it, or are you going to act about it and move on? You're going to act about it and move on. So today's time, you may have big thoughts, you may have big plans, but you need to act on it and you need to be fast about it. Because believe you me, I didn't realize when I reached here and I became a key speaker as against a person who was studying over there on the other side of the stage. So the time does move fast and you will not realize that. The second key theory that you need to work with is bold beats old. I know I'm old and I'm waiting to be beaten. But all around you right now, there are countless number of people and organizations who are out to mess up your business model and learning. They want to tell you differently. They want to tell you things that may or may not be something that you've learned in school. But that's not the real story. Always remember that bold thinkers make bold steps, aggressive moves, and big decisions. You want to be one of the thousands, or you want to be just many of the thousands, is a call you take. You young boys and girls have to take that call. And the fact that you're going to take bold and beat the old is where your strength is. And my third point is velocity trumps strategy. Careful strategic planning can be a critical step in adapting to the future. But in some areas, things are happening so fast that you can't take time to strategize. You just need to jump in and go. Have you ever heard the saying, swim in the deep end of the ocean? That's what we mean. You jump into it and you learn as you move along. But what makes you get to the other side? Can anybody tell me what makes you to get to the other side? Your education, your backup, your learnings from the business school. That's what helps you get to the other side. And if you're fast, like I said in one of the traits, you'll be one of the first few to get onto the other side. You think and you keep planning, you're just going to drown. That's the experiential capital, the experiential growth that we are looking at as an industry. You need to understand it and you need to invest on it now. Like I said, I'm not going to be talking too much about presentations, or I'm not going to be talking too much about what we all know and what we don't, what I know and what I don't. My learning may or may not be relevant to you, but your questions are very relevant to you. You need to ask me what happens and how it happens. Are we aligned with the business schools or not is a question that I would like to answer today for my industry, where I belong to, which is the hotelering business. We learn a lot, but unfortunately, what we don't know how to learn is human behavior. And hotels, fundamentally, is one of the key industries that deals with human behavior. We do not know how the next person is going to act. We do not know how the next person is going to react. We don't know what the next person is going to ask for. But we are expected to have the answers. Am I right or am I wrong? I'm sure all of you have been in hotels. When you walk into the hotel, you wait for the other person in the hotel to have an answer for your problem. Is that correct?
Yes.
But did you share that problem with anybody when you got in? But you're still expecting that person to have a solution for you, right?
Yes.
That's hotelering for you. How did we learn that? We learned that art, or we learned that skill, by being connected to our guests, by being connected to our people, by talking to our guests and our people and anticipating what's coming. And how do I do that? How do I stay connected to my guests and how do I anticipate what my guest wants? Anybody up there? By taking feedback, all right. How do you get the art of taking feedback? How do you understand taking feedback? Communication, right? I heard somebody say communication there. Where do you get the art of communication from? Art of communication through experience. Is that it? Are you telling me all of you don't know how to communicate? I'm sure if you want a day off, you'll know how to communicate with your dean. I'm sure if you all want to have a party tomorrow night, you'll know how to communicate. So are you telling me only experience teaches you how to communicate? It's your backup education. It's this what you learn today that you take onto the table tomorrow. That is what is relevant. What is relevant for you really is not the fact that do I know it all? You can never know it all. I'm still learning. I'm still learning various aspects of my business. But do I know it all? No, I don't. Do I have answers for everybody? No, I don't. But I do know that the education and the background that I have been given, the key skills that my school and my education has given me, has allowed me to deal with those situations today the way I do deal with them. I've had my fair share of learning. I did start my career, like somebody said, in Jet Airways, and I was a flight steward. And I'm talking of a time when Jet Airways was a startup company. Did I learn everything? No. But I did take the plunge. I jumped into the deep end of the sea and I said, I want to do this. How did I get that confidence? I got that confidence from the institute, from the learnings, from the schools, from my teachers who allowed me to believe in myself and equipped me with the right skills to believe in myself. I know all of you have a lot of questions in your mind. I've been briefed by some of your peers and colleagues who've been spending the entire day with me that a lot of you want to join hotels, a lot of you have questions, a lot of you want to know what is right and what is wrong and are you equipped or not. I will leave the house open for all of you to ask questions because I honestly, like I said in the beginning, believe in a lot of interactive sessions. My learnings may or may not be yours. Your learnings can definitely be mine. And this is a session where I want you to ask me so that you know what you're thinking is on the right track or not. If there is something that you feel that today should or should not be done, you should put it out on the table. Nobody has all the answers, but at least we can try and get you some. That's my logic in life. That's my mantra in life. To follow what you believe in and to always and always make sure your goal is in sight. Some of the challenges you'll definitely feel. So I've been made to understand, sir, all of them have 2 months of internship in the final. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And all of you have been across industries in the last 2 months. Yes?
Yes.
Does that make you any different from now, from earlier?
Yes, sir.
How? I just hear a lot of murmuring, like I said, something wrong. How are you different today than what you were 4 months back? Attitude. I heard somebody say attitude. Okay. What about it? Your attitude has gotten worse or it's gotten better? Are you all more confident? Are you all more, do you all feel more prepared? I can't hear this. I see a lot of people sleeping here already. Okay, fine. That's better. So actually that came because they have to wake up. So, do you feel more prepared to go out in the world?
Yes.
Are you more confident that you'll be able to go out and get a job?
Yes, sir.
Why do you feel that? Because you were in the job. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
So now you can come back and you can identify what you want to take with you when you're going for that job. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
That's what the business school is all about. But you need to be fast, guys, because one of the biggest challenges that is faced by the industry today is the relevance of all of you with the actual job that's happening on the floor. There are a lot of challenges in hotels we face. Are you all equipped to face that challenge? We don't know. Is 2 months going to teach you everything? We don't know. But these are the challenges that you need to come forward and believe in yourself and take. Nobody can teach you that. So on that note, any questions for me so far? Okay, so her question is, she went for training, and please correct me if I'm wrong, and this is for the benefit of all of you. The question she asked is that she did an internship for 2 months, but the internship that she did was not from the specialization that she was studying. And if in real life you are ever faced with a situation where you are put in front of a situation what you're not specialized in, how would you cope with that? Is that correct? Okay. Let me ask you a very, very basic home question. You were in school. I know you are 365 days. You know, I was telling my team today, I said these students study 365 days in a year and my staff doesn't even want to work 65 days. So, I mean, I'm really impressed and I think I'm in awe of all of you and I'm going to go back and inculcate this into my team. 365 days working. They are obviously going to come behind you, sir, because you are the one who invited me here. But anyways, very simple question. You were in school. You were going back home. You were expecting mama to make rajma chawal with aloo. And you get home and you see she's made ghee and she's made rice and she's made, that's it, with pyaaz and achar. What do? A expected situation versus an unexpected one. What do you do?
I'm very hungry, so obviously I have to eat whatever she's made.
Does she answer your question? So honestly, what happens in a situation when you are faced with a problem which you are not equipped to deal with, you find your own solutions and you take your own decisions. The person who is scared to fall is the person who will never learn to rise. Remember that. Because if I'm standing here, I can't fly. Can I fly? So how do I rise? So you have to learn. So to answer your questions, even though you went for an internship of 2 months in an area which is not your specialization, did it teach you something? It taught you something? What? Confidence?
The way to solve various problems, to think out of the box a lot, and confidence, yes. And how to work in a corporate place, which is on strategic level.
That's fantastic. So I think you answered your question on your own, where you fundamentally answered the point that nothing is irrelevant. Everything has a reason and everything is relevant. How you want to interpret that is a choice you make. Next question, please. Thank you so much. Yes, please.
Sir, here. So first of all, it's our pleasure to have you here today.
Thank you.
And also, just to add a little here, I have also done, I have an experience of 3 years in hotel industry, and one of my colleagues is working with you, there at Vivanta Taj Dwarika.
Me?
Yeah. Okay. Ritika Papad, she's taking care of marketing and communication there,
yes.
I believe.
Yes.
Okay, so I just want to understand from you that how do you think that an MBA graduate will add value with your hospitality? Once we go back from here, how do you think that, the post-graduation program will help us to grow in the industry?
Okay, let me take your interview in front of 300 or 400 people right now. Maybe you're applying for a job with me at Vivanta that has to offer.
I'm sorry?
What do you bring onto the table and why do you think I should hire you?
So, see, honestly speaking, I think that I was not, I mean, I was working with Marriott then, and I was into sales only. So, I was not through with my MBA program. So now when I've come here, so I've done. So there is upgradation in my degree. And I believe that I hold a little of experience at how the corporate exactly works also. So if I go back from here, I think that I'll be having an added advantage there to work with you.
Are you people just asking me questions to make me happy? Because you seem to have all the answers anyways.
No, it's just that I wanted to understand because I believe that the growth there within the industry is a little slow, which I perceived that time when I was working with the, within the company.
Okay. So that actually says the point that I was mentioning earlier. You're the Gen X. You're the generation of instant gratification, whether it's instant noodles, instant microwave food, or it's instant recognition. Life is not instant, young man, let me tell you that. It is not something that happens overnight. While I know that you're all in that immediate reaction, sometimes some things do take time. Growth is a direct reflection of your capabilities and your ability. It's a healthy mix of your capabilities and your ability. The fact that you've now done a master's in business administration and you have taken certain courses to equip yourself with an additional skill set. The degree aspect is different, please. I'm talking about a skill set which is given to you while you are in the institute. Allows you to get onto the fast track. That's answering point number one. How are you relevant to sales and marketing in the hotel industry after leaving from here and doing an MBA? Am I right? That was your first question. Second question, acceleration, growth being slow. That's direct reflection of your ability and capability. If you are capable and you have the skill set, you think you have the ability to perform a duty which is required at the next level, you need to display that for the management to be able to see it. Why do you think you had to come and do MBA? Let me ask you a reverse question.
So I believe that if I do an MBA, like after going from the college, I think it'll be easier for me to understand because when I was working there with Marriott, I believe that there were a lot of challenges which I was not able to handle then. And I think that there are a few things which I can improvise after doing MBA. So it's basically to understand how exactly it's going to work later.
So you wanted to acquire additional skill set, is that correct?
That's true. That's true.
You answered your own question and thank you for answering mine. MBA has allowed you to acquire some additional skill sets which make you more prepared and make you more relevant for the next role in your life. You need to go and display what you've learned in the job that you decide to take on for the management and then for the organization to give you that opportunity.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, on your right. Sir, on your right, here.
Okay, yeah, hi.
Sir, my question comes in...
Can I have your names, please?
Ananya Dubey, sir.
Sorry?
Ananya Dubey.
Mr. Dubey.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So my question comes to you in light of my understanding of corporate tie-ups and subscription program that hospital
corporate
industry.
Slowly. I'm old. Yeah.
So sir, the corporate tie-ups or the subscription program that hospitality industry sells to corporates just to lock in the customers. I just wanted to understand, being a marketing and sales guy, how do you convince your customers or big corporates to do these tie-ups or to pay you upfront a hefty amount, even when there's uncertainty that their executives
I should teach you everything. Come and take my job. and I'll be happy to give it to you. I'm ready to retire in a couple of months. The first and foremost thing, and this is again some of the discussions I've been having with a lot of you while I've been trying to get here. Whenever you decide to take up a job, please believe in it. Please believe in it. Do not, and I say this again with a lot of conviction, and having done that mistake, do not do a job because you have to do a job. When you take up a job and you believe in it, whether it's a product or it's a service, you automatically will know how to sell it because you yourself believe in it. Everything has a point of differentiation. When you were selecting an MBA institute or a master's institute, a postgraduate institute, did you have options in front of you?
Yeah.
Yes? You had, let's say, 3 colleges or 4 colleges? Yes? Why did you choose this? And why did you agree to pay 15% or 10% more than all the other MBA institutes or master's institutes? Because there was a point of difference. There was something extra that you were getting here. There was something different that you were going to learn here. Is that correct? Yes or no?
Right.
Okay, no. So that answers your question. As a sales and marketing professional, as a person who fundamentally runs the show in terms of driving the revenues and income of my hotel, I am extremely convinced that the business that I'm running behind or the piece of business that I'm pitching for is very relevant to my unit, to my hotel. And with that, I'm able to put everything that I'm going to be able to offer to that gentleman, which maybe some other person is not being able to offer, and make my product so desirable that he eventually wants it. Now, when he wants it, he has to pay for it. Because if he doesn't, I'm going to go and sell it to someone else. These are strategies that you make as you go into the system. So you have to create the classic scenario of a demand and supply. You've built your demand. Now you need to close it. And that's what the game is. Thank you. Anything else? I hope I've answered your question. Great.
Good afternoon, sir.
Hi.
My name is Shivam Gupta.
Hi, Shivam.
Actually, my question is regarding artificial intelligence coming in today's scenario, like it's going in every vertical. So how it's affecting the hospitality, and is it cutting the jobs in the hospitality sector? Or
define artificial intelligence.
Regarding artificial is mostly focusing towards the business analysis and or going more deeply is deciding the prices of the hotels per day, prices and the menus and different kind of things.
That's a very good question. And like all industries, the hospitality or the service industry has also been bitten by the electronic bug. There are pros and cons to it. There are goods and bads to it. I'd like to believe there's a lot good to it, a lot more to add than to take away as far as we as hoteliers are concerned. Today, electronic media, intelligence, market intelligence, competition reports, competition capabilities, all of this is put under one roof for us to analyze, to be able to price ourselves at the right price point and to make sure that nobody has a lose-it situation, but me and the client both have a win-win situation. I don't want to be in a position where I'm underselling, and neither do I want to be in a position where I'm overpricing. But how do I find that perfect price point? How do I find that absolute point at which I want to position myself? How do I do that? How would you do it if you didn't have anybody? How would you identify the right price for a product? Sorry, somebody said? Market, something? So you'd identify it with demand. What else? So you would use that artificial, thank you. You would use that artificial intelligence to understand what are the trends in the market to be able to price yourself at an appropriate level so that neither are you underselling nor are you overpricing. You need to be relevant. If you're not relevant to the game, you're not playing the game. And to be able to be relevant to the game, I need to know what's happening. Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir. Up right, left, sir.
Hi, good afternoon. Oh, you're there,
yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, my name is Radhika.
Radhika.
Radhika,
hi.
So I'm from BIMM, and I wanted to ask a question related to the hotel industry, and as being GST being rolled out, and Vivanta by Taj comes under the 28% slab. So how does it affecting the sales, and is affecting it in a positive way or a negative way in the long run?
The only personal way it's going to affect me is that if my wife, every time she goes shopping, the bill has gone up because the tax percentage has gone up. So that's really the personal implication as far as GST is concerned. GST is a very government-driven topic. A lot has been said and written about it. I think you need to really go on. I wouldn't be the right person or the right expertise to really give you a comment on GST's implication on the hotel industry because it's way too new and we are still assessing out how, in which direction it's going to go. All I can tell you is as per the GST norms and regulations, GST is calculated on the registered tariff that the hotel has for a particular room category in the system with the government. It's not got to do with what I'm selling it to you for. It's got more to what I've registered it with the government. And on the basis of that, there are two tax slabs that have been given to the hotel industry. There's an 18% and a 28%, depending on what price point I've registered my rooms at. And on that basis, it's calculated. Food and beverage has a different calculation, and there is a different understanding of food and beverage taxation. Where it is now come down to a flat 18%. From a consumer perspective, I think a lot is there on the net. I'll encourage you to go and look at it. It's a great study board, guys, and if you all, boys and girls, have interest in the taxation philosophies of the world and the country, it's a great reading material for you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Oh, hello, young man. So that's the guy. Yes.
Thank you for being here, and
thank you for being
a wonderful mentor.
Thank you.
So my question is, during the 2 months, I learned that Dwarka is a major residential area and there is no corporate presence in that area. So how you and your team managed to meet the budget and expectation of the Taj?
So he's the boy who came to me from your institute and he said, we have a beautiful campus. And I kept telling him, I said, well, I don't know whether the applaud is for you or for me, but nevertheless, I love taking the glory, you know that. He has a question. I don't know, for some of you who have not been in Delhi and in Dwarka, let me give you a quick insight. This hotel is a 250-room property that I'm working for. It's the newest baby on the Taj portfolio. It's located in a residential, outright residential area, and there is no commercial area at least about 5 to 7 kilometers off that hotel. I think the closest commercial area is actually about, 11 kilometers, not even 7. And yes, so how do we get business in that and how do we meet and beat our budgets? So somebody asked me a question earlier, how would I handle a situation if I'm put in front of the lions and I've been told survive. It was pretty much a game of survival, supply and demand. And I was very convinced about the product. So it's an amalgamation of all the questions you people ask me. I was very convinced about the product. I was very sure that I'm going to be able to give my clients something which is very different, which is very, very, how should I put it, very relevant to their need. And we customized our hotel services to the demand of the client in the market. And that's how we took it out. I have a fantastic team. You were a part of it. Thank you. I have a fantastic team that has been with me. They've been with me from the inception of that hotel, which is now almost 3 years. And they stood by me. So collectively as a team, we've all believed in that hotel. We've all believed in the Taj, which is an institution by its own. And I've had a whole lot of support from the overall company to be able to position myself and sell that hotel. Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir.
Hi, good afternoon.
So straight in front.
Yeah, hi.
Yeah, hi. My name is Nisha.
Hi, Nisha.
I wanted to ask you a direct question. If someone was to join your team,
sales
and marketing,
yes.
apart from the three qualities that you mentioned, that the person should be fast, bold, and have velocity.
Oh, you've been listening. Fabulous. Good. Yes.
What are the other key skill sets that a person should have for joining your team?
50% of your job is done because you've been listening to me. I'll tell you that. And we'll talk offline. But on a serious note, I think what I really look at is dynamics, and I look at the gift of the gab, I like to call it. Your ability to be able to sell yourself to me. You're coming into sales and marketing. If you can't sell yourself, you can't sell anything. So I think that's pretty much what's going to get you the job, not just with me, but with anybody. And I know the person who does that best, my 13-year-old daughter. She sells herself very well to me, so she'll give you some tips on that. Thank you.
Sir, you're to your right.
Hi.
So my name is Abhishek Tiwari.
Hi.
And my question is related to your industry. Now, first of all, sir, it is about the disruptive technology or the idea in hotel industry. So first question is that, do you measure Airbnb or OYO rooms or Stay Uncle as your competitor? And if you do, so how do you cope up or how are you planning to compete with especially Airbnb? Because they are actually targeting this premium segment. So how do you think?
These are very different business model. So that's an interesting question. Long answer. I'm not sure if everybody would be inclined to it. I can have a session with you on that separately offline as well after I'm done. The hotel industry works through various segments. So we have a no star to a so-called seven star, right? Every segment has its own defined brands and competition analysis and people who they want to compete with. And that's how we really work. Do they disrupt my level of business? Are they relevant to me? Would it make a difference to me? Of course, everybody's relevant. They are as relevant to me as the next person. How much are they going to impact me really depends on my strategy and what kind of business am I. So what is it that OYO or Airbnb is looking at versus what am I looking at? I think we need to sit down and analyze that before we can make a strategy whether or not they are impacting me or are they affecting. So on that note, I'd like to thank everybody. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for staying awake. You've been a fabulous audience, and give yourself a round of applause.